This is my keyboard. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Oh wait, it doesn't say anything. I just type with it. Well, this joke sure went nowhere. You know, I like to start with something funny. Never mind.
Epic Fail. The Wacky World of Multimedia J.
First off, that is peppermint and chamomile herb tea from Aldi that I basically added the same stuff to that I would normally add to regular tea in the morning. That's why it's so light. I think I don't need to add as much additives to tea when it already is somewhat sweet on its own. But yes, we're taking a look at some membrane keyboards today and bringing back basically a live element of these discussions instead of doing everything cinematic. Because the biggest issue with the old over-the-shoulder format was simply rambling too much in the beginning. So here we are, membrane keyboards. This is the thing that gets people making fun of me like you wouldn't believe when they find out that I have no problem whatsoever with membrane keyboards. And of course, since I did grow up in the 90s, the dysfunctional end-of-the-century decade in the 20th century, I'm sure some folks out there may recognize the reference when I refer to these as insane membrane keyboards. Because, aside from that old school rap, insane in the membrane, I knew some people that used to love that stuff. There was another couple other things too that I kept hearing from them in those days, where everybody and their mother's uncle had a drum machine. But anyways, nostalgia aside, these days, if you say you have no problem with membrane keyboards, there are numerous elitists out there that give you all kinds of flack. Because, what? You must be certifiably nuts! Why don't you have a mechanical keyboard, you idiot? Mechanical keyboards are amazing! Membrane keyboards suck! Blah, 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 blah. Well, we're actually going to talk about every single one of these tonight. And not one of these is mechanical. Now that I've kind of, sort of, started cleaning up the project area, I can get back here again. First off, let's take a look at this little specimen right over here. This is the Microsoft Wired 600. This is the non-mechanical keyboard that I would get these days. It's one of those cheap $20 to $30 bottom of the barrel. I've actually got this and its predecessor several years ago for $20. Now the thing is, for those of you that are new to this argument, mechanical versus membrane keyboards represent a change in keyboard technology from the end of the 80s into the 90s to today, where the old school typewriter-esque or even word processor-esque clackety-clack keyboards of the 80s and 90s gave way to way more comfortable, softer keys. But some people like the clackety-clack, and some people also like that some of the old key switches will actuate without having to press the key all the way down. So you can actually just type away without having to bottom everything out all the time. Today's keyboards, at least at the low end, are membrane keyboards where there's a big piece of rubber and you're basically pushing a button to bring two rubber contacts together, and that of course sends the key, hence the whole membrane key and of course my little joke, insane membrane keyboards nowadays. So this thing of of course, bottom of the barrel in terms of price, but not bottom of the barrel in terms of quality. I know why people hate rubber dome membrane keyboards. It's because of keyboards like this one, or the Logitech K120, which is even cheaper. This is an HP keyboard, but the minute I saw this for under $10, I was like, yeah, right. Just because there's an HP logo on it doesn't mean it's going to be high quality, and I don't even know if you would even get this keyboard if you bought an HP computer, but we'll get to that one shortly. Let's get back to the Microsoft one here. I've been a fan of Microsoft keyboards for many, many years. These came with all the school computers back in the 90s, and of course they're actually squishier and spongier back then. So actually, you know, the whole membrane thing with softer, like you're typing on cotton and stuff like that, you don't have, you know, you're not hitting a hard bottom on the keys or something along those lines. I actually didn't mind that, but yes, there are issues with reliability and how long these things last versus their mechanical counterparts. But if there's any membrane keyboard that I think gets it right, it's definitely anything from Microsoft. Microsoft's hardware division, for some strange reason, even before they started making Xboxes, was able to put out some very, very competent hardware. Like, for example, the IntelliMouse Explorer 3, which I've obviously worn this one to pieces, but this thing still works. I also have my original IntelliMouse Explorer 3 from the early 2000s that still works. The problem with those mice is that there's now like $8 monoprice gaming mice that match the functionality of this thing without having to hold on to such an old piece of technology that lasted so long that Microsoft basically had to do a renewal on the design and send out an updated design later. But there are $10 gaming mice or less, like the monoprice gaming mouse, that will do what an IntelliMouse Explorer 3 used to do back in its day. So it had its day. In terms of the keyboard side of things, I used to use Microsoft Digital Media Pro, the two-tone silver and black keyboards from the mid-2000s, and basically it matched the silver bullet quite well back when silver was a more popular color for computers. And this was the successor with another digital media keyboard from the Windows 7 era, as you can tell by the window key there, what it's shaped like. It's soft, it's a membrane keyboard, it's not that bad of a membrane keyboard though, but, you know, if I was going to be stuck with a membrane keyboard, I'd want to be stuck with one of these, or the substantially more ergonomic Microsoft Natural, which keeps your wrists like this instead of flattening them all the time. Basically, this was the descendant of the Digital Media Pros that I used to use. There was one fatal flaw, though. I'm a touch typist, and I also play video games using the touch typing home row, so I do ASDF instead of WASD, so I don't scrunch my fingers together. And it's basically just like typing, except I'm playing a video game. The problem is, from a touch typing perspective, these function keys do not work, because they're all together, as opposed to 1, 2, 3, 4, gap, 5, 6, 7, 8, gap, 9, 10, 11, 12, gap, and the utility keys. So that ultimately, very quickly, retired this keyboard, and it is now used for, like, test setups and things like that. It's over in the project area nowadays, but the successor to that, of course, the branding changed as we went from Windows 7 to Windows 8 and 10, is, of course, the Wired 600, which is basically the one and only membrane keyboard that I can actually recommend, but it has this thing for some of the rubber feet coming off on one side before the other, so you get some of that going on. Eventually they all come off and you can get some replacements or something like that, but basically this is it. I had a Windows 7 version of this earlier, and that of course had that type of window key instead of this newer one for Windows 8 and 10, and of course Microsoft looked a little different as well. Calculator button and things along those lines. The fun part about these Wired 600s is that if you like a little bit of clack to your keys, like an old school keyboard, as you wear these in and you break down the rubber and cause a little bit of wear and tear, they actually get slightly clackier than they are. When you first get them, it's like typing on cotton. It's kind of like this, very quiet, very, very soft. But eventually you do start getting some clackiness as things break in and you get some wear and tear. Particularly if you take the whole keyboard apart and you clean out the inside of it and whatnot, as well as cleaning all the rubber and putting it back together, getting all the gunk out that gets in there from as you use it and break it in. Of course, that does mean the number pad usually is close to the way it is out of the box for the longest. But basically, yes, this is definitely something I can recommend. Also, there is one very important thing regarding the issues with membrane rubber dome technology. People hate membrane and rubber dome stuff. It's horrible. It's terrible. You want a mechanical keyboard. Oh no, rubber domes are horrible. I have one thing to say to every single person that thinks that rubber dome technology is horrible for gaming. Have you ever used a game controller in your life? What do you think this is? Is there a clicky Cherry MX switch underneath these buttons? No! You take this thing apart, you're gonna find the exact same contact points being brought together, the D-pad, the buttons, the works. That's how video game controllers operate, and it's perfectly fine when the video game controller is rubber dome, but it's horrible when the keyboard runs off of the exact same technology, even when you're using a keyboard as a gaming peripheral. So if it works similar to a video game controller because you're playing keyboard mouse games, why is that such an issue? Answer me that question, all you mechanical keyboard elitists out there. Especially when some of the key switch types will actually actuate when you only partially press the key, so you run the risk of fat fingering things in games a little more because you don't have to actually push the buttons to make it act, to make the system act like you pushed the button. So, that's the ultimate irony with this elitism out there about mechanical keyboards. Membrane keyboards are so horrible until they're perfectly acceptable when you're using a video game controller. Yeah, riddle me this. But there's a very good reason why people hate membrane keyboards, and it has something to do with this piece of crap over here. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the HP SUX 9000. Well, what is it really? It's the K45. Woohoo! This is my first experiment with a sub $10 keyboard to see what kind of mileage I could get out of a keyboard this cheap. And the answer is, it's more annoying than some of the pack-in keyboards that come with off-the-shelf computers. And I've used some pretty bad membrane rubber dome keyboards from the OEMs, especially Dell. Oh man, I was trying to code one time in our satellite building, so I didn't have my usual Microsoft Natural keyboard, and that was a total disaster. All of it. Half the keys, I guess someone might have spilt something in that one because half the keys didn't work half the time. I was just waiting for the time I tried to type shift in an email about shifts and something else went to, you know, managers and people in the company and stuff like that. So yeah, there's a reason why people hate membrane keyboards and these cheapies that don't, you know, use the same level of quality as most Microsoft hardware, and even Logitech has some decent stuff, but I find the plastic on Logitech stuff to be cheaper than what's used in Microsoft's hardware. But anyways, this HP thing is the reason why people hate membrane keyboards. It's outrageously light, which is why I traditionally use it on my secondary system, because I just move it around out of the way and toss it somewhere with zero effort. I can pick this thing up with one hand without even batting an eye, even when torque doesn't work out for me. Yay! But this thing basically rubber domes the living daylights out of it. I mean, if you've ever used a mechanical keyboard or an old school typewriter, this is the polar opposite. It is bad. Basically, it's almost a disservice to call this thing a keyboard. It might be a little more accurate to say that it's a button board, because that's what it feels like. And there are actually some membrane keyboards out there that are basically little chiclet buttons, similar to what's in the laptops, except a little bit bigger. But anyways, the action on these, actually I can type faster on these because the rubber on this thing is practically spring-loaded. I've been trying to break this thing in to see if that would change as I put some wear and tear on this thing, but it's not as spongy and smooshy as the worst membrane keyboards I've ever used. But basically, the reason why I can type faster with this thing, cheap piece of junk, than with this thing, my usual favorite for non-mechanical keyboards, the reason why I can type faster with this thing is that the rubber on the membrane is so spring-loaded it almost vaults your finger into the air when you're letting go. That doesn't work out so well when trying to use this as a gaming peripheral, when you're just like, yeah, FSD, jump FSD, da-da-da-da-da. Doesn't really work out too well when you're trying to use it as a gaming peripheral. Another problem I have is because I'm a touch typer, the lack of a space between the end of the regular keyboard and the utility keys and the number pad causes issues. This is all too smooshed together. There should be a gap over here, so sometimes I get confused about hitting insert or hitting delete, because I'm used to there being the space, so to speak. Nope, wanna hit the delete key? It's a bit harder when you're not looking at it because there's, you know, it's almost like, am I hitting this key instead or something like that? So, yeah, this is why people hate membrane keyboards, and this is why, you know, get like a $5 keyboard. If you want to do an experiment to see what you can do with a $5 keyboard, at least it's $5 wasted and not like way more if it doesn't work out for you. This is largely a utility keyboard. It's a backup, so to speak, and because it's so outrageously light, it is my keyboard of choice when I'm working on a secondary system off to the side. So yeah, this is why people hate membrane keyboards, right here. There's no real quality here, it's thin plastic, and it's basically like boom, 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 you move all at once. There's like there's no action in the middle here. And of course, the rubber is so springy it vaults your fingers back up into the air when you're done pressing down with full force. So yeah, it's nothing at all like this. This feels a lot more smooth, and like a lot more thought went into how this feels, and this could be sold as a decent office peripheral for people that, you know, maybe not touch typists that want something mechanical, but for somebody working at a desk and maybe, you know, looking in a spreadsheet and typing every so often that isn't typing all day long, this will work just fine. And it actually will be a step up from the OEM peripherals that come with the computer. But if there are HP computers out there that come with these things, I pity the fool. Yeah, right, I'm not even close to Mr. T. I pity those bozos that are stuck with these things. Definitely get something newer. Like one of these, even, if you don't just move up to something mechanical. But yes, that's the situation with membrane keyboards. I would get a Logitech just to compare it to these two, but I think there'd be no concentrated coolness after recording the video. Basically, I want to use the Microsoft one as my main keyboard. This one underneath, that with the lousy layout, is over in the project area, and this one is used for system number two because of how absurdly light it is, and I don't really do a lot of typing anyways. I could always just switch this to another system if I want to basically work with... something with a little bit more typing or gaming or something. I gotta clean this thing out, see how much clackier it gets when I clean out the rubber. With this thing though, I don't know if I'll ever be able to break this thing in properly. It's just, the more I use it, the more I want to switch back to this thing. So, anyways, that's the situation with insane membrane keyboards. Oh, and one more thing before we plug this thing back in and actually demonstrate how quiet it is versus the click, 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 click I often hear from people that are using mechanical keyboards for gaming. There's a lot of talk about the lifespan of these things in terms of cost versus how long they last versus keystrokes and the like and whatnot. My question is, those of you who just casually use a computer at home and you're not typing all day long, have you ever actually hit the keystroke limit on a membrane keyboard? That's the question. I've never once replaced a membrane keyboard because I had a key completely wear out on me or anything like that. It's always because of other forms of wear and tear. The plastic yellowed. In the case of the Digital Media Pros, I took all the paint off here and here from my palms being on it for so much time, and things along those lines. Might take the paint off a key if the key wasn't a different color plastic, or if the thing wasn't a different color plastic to begin with. So, basically, I have never once completely worn out a membrane keyboard and to the point where I wanted to replace it. So as far as I'm concerned, the talk about longevity is moot. If you're talking like 10 times longer, if you don't use your computer 10 times more than, you know, you would otherwise with a membrane keyboard, then what's the point? I mean, you may have plastic yellow on you, you may just want a new style or something like that. Yeah, you could swap out the keys and things along those lines, but that's the thing. I mean, this actually replaced a five-year-old version of this that wasn't all that bad, actually. I think what ultimately did it in was this design with the wire. Got a little too crushed and stuff, and eventually it went intermittent because the wire had simply been bent too many times. So again, the mechanical wear and tear, or should I say the wear and tear in general, on my last membrane keyboard was not because I typed on it too much. So, get all this talk about cost versus cost-benefit analysis and all that stuff about membrane keyboards versus mechanical keyboards and how many keystrokes everything is supposed to last, but, you know, the mathematical keystroke totals and whatnot, expected time before failure, just doesn't pan out in the real world. There are so many other things that can happen that might make you want to replace your keyboard besides the thing actually breaking. And again, the thing actually breaking is something I have yet to experience, at least from wearing out the typing. It would break from some other reason like the wire issues or something along those lines. But that's the thing. I've never really... And even as heavy of a computer user as I am, I have yet to totally wreck one of these things from simply typing on it too much. Oh my goodness, Rubber Domes is so terrible, it's so horrible, it's so awful, used in musical instruments, too. Funny that. It's almost like the technology doesn't totally suck.
Okay, now we're going to do a little demonstration of how this performs in-game, if I get the DPI right on this mouse. Camcorder Let's Play style, so not all that great. But I'm going to, first with game sound and then without, just demonstrate the quietness that is using a membrane keyboard as a video game controller by, of course, my guy bunny hopping all over the place. So, you need to hit something, maybe you hear like the plastic of the key and stuff, but otherwise, dead silent. Okay, so the glitches weren't all being caused by some other stuff. So super scaling wasn't the source of the glitches when I was testing that earlier. Alright, let's kill a few enemies here. There we go. But get some line of sight there. And nothing. As opposed to you hear people with mechanical keyboards and you hear the click-a-click-a-click every time they push a key and stuff like that. That's another thing too, it's a style thing. I mean, I associate rubber dome technology with video game controllers. And I also associate the quietness of video game controllers. You don't actually hear the controller when you're playing the video game. The clacky noise and the clicky-clack of mechanical keyboards, I actually associate more with an office than having fun at home. So there's definitely a psychological component to the whole mechanical keyboard thing. Also, a psychological component and nostalgia for maybe people that had the clackety-clack IBM keyboards of the 80s and 90s. But this, you know, since the keyboard does double as a game controller, I don't mind if it's a quiet membrane device. Now, let's show the quietness even more by hitting the mute button and just killing the in-game sound. Now, I would not play under these conditions. You know, I would not normally play under these conditions, but let's say you're trying to have, like, some kind of... Let's say you're trying to have some kind of gaming session when everybody else in the house is trying to sleep and you're wearing a headset and hopefully you don't have Cherry MX Blues or something. Oh, man. You can tell I'm a nerd. I'm making jokes about mechanical keyboards. You can hear cars going by a lot more than you can hear this thing. I'm going to shut up for a bit. Listen to that. Nice and quiet. And a couple of people shooting bandits. You hear passing cars a lot more than you hear the gaming peripherals. So, you know, you hear more of the game and you hear less of click, 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 clack, 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 clack. Or whatever, depending on what switch you have. You know, I've actually heard some mechanical keyboards that don't sound that much different from membrane keyboards. They have some weird switch type or something like that. They're not half mechs either. They're fully mechanical. It's just the switch types are so quiet and whatnot that you basically just... And of course, jumping with the space bar. Of course, there's a bit of an issue with the space bar being a little loose on these Microsoft keyboards. But again, it's like pushing a button on a video game controller because it literally is the exact same technology. I think even my mouse is louder than this keyboard. How come this guy... Oh, there we go. I thought my dodge roll got unmapped there. Oh, not enough energy. Oh, okay. I can weapon switch. And actually, the mouse is louder than the keyboard is. So, maybe I need a rubber dome mouse that isn't as clicky. They do make them, actually. They do not rubber dome mice, but they do make mice that are made to be quiet when you click them and stuff like that. So, you know, wake up the house. But I'm actually doing some very complicated moves with multiple buttons being pressed at once here, and you hear maybe a little bit of rattling from the plastic, but now even if I hit things hard, you know, it keeps things nice and quiet. So when I put the sound back on, well, there we go. HDMI sound can be a little screwy sometimes. What little noise is left completely goes away, and all I hear is the sounds of the game. Fun stuff. Yar! Alright. It looks like this is capping at 60 with everything maxed out anyway, so... Best appearance and everything. This machine totally sneezes at Guild Wars 2. Alright. Well, that's gonna wrap things up here. Actually, let's get out of here and let's load up to... I for inventory in this game. Let's go to the Eye of the North and just wrap things up there. So there you have it. You'll hear passing cars, idling cars, bozos idling their cars for way too long, things like that. A lot more than you will hear the noise associated with the right membrane keyboard. If you get the wrong Insane Membrane keyboard, it will be a disastrous gaming experience. But I definitely can recommend the Microsoft Wired 600 as a basic, rudimentary, non-mechanical keyboard, and it's the only one that I would really get anymore. I think if I wanted to be more adventurous with keyboards, I would check out the mechanical keyboard scene. But for now, so long as I am not using mechanical keyboards, I will most certainly continue using the tried, trusted, and true, even if kind of related to office work, Microsoft Hardware Division's products. Even though it's so entry-level and kind of bleh for a market these days, that the design on the Wired 600 hasn't really changed in over 5 years. I mean, I had the Windows 7 version of this before I had the Windows 8 and 10 version of it. I'm going to keep playing me some Guild Wars 2 here. Till next time, this is Multimedia Jay, signing off. Thanks for stopping by.